Thank you so much, Dr. Edwards. Good morning. We're glad to welcome each one of you to our worship service today. We trust that you will experience the presence of God as we invest these next few moments together here in the worship of the living God. Before we begin our worship, though, there are just a couple of announcements that I would call your attention to. Just a reminder that coming up on October the 27th, that's Tuesday, from 2 to 6, we'll be hosting a Red Cross blood drive here in our fellowship hall. The times are between 2 and 6 p.m. And if you need to make reservation or further information, simply call Pat Neely, and he will be able to give you the information that you need. Also, just would remind you that the November 1st is the deadline to turn in the shoe boxes. We don't have any more left. So if you missed out this year, I'm sorry, they'll be next year. But those who did, November the 1st is the hard deadline to get those in. And also, the Finance Committee has completed their work on the 2021 budget, and they'll be having a church conference to discuss that on Wednesday, November the 18th at 6 o'clock here in the sanctuary. If you'd like to get a copy of that and you're not coming by the church office, they'll be available there in the narthex. But if you need to have one mailed to you, just simply call the church office and make that request, and we'll make sure that you get that in a timely manner. Now, those are all the announcements we'll touch base on. We hope that you will look for the other places of information that may pertain to you and your family. But as we begin our worship here, the reading of Psalm 99. Psalm 99. The Lord reigns, let the nations tremble. He sits enthroned between the cherubim, and let the earth shake. Great is the Lord in Zion. He is exalted over all the nations. Let them praise your great and awesome name. He is holy. The king is mighty. He loves justice. You have established equity in Jacob. You have done what is just and right. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his footstool. He is holy. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel was among those who called on his name. They called on the Lord and he answered them. He spoke to them from the pillar of cloud. They kept his statutes and the decrees he gave them. The Lord our God, you answered them. You were to Israel a forgiving God, though you punished their misdeeds. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. May the Lord bless those words to our hearts and to our lives this day. Let's bow for our opening prayer. Eternal God, we agree with the psalmist who reminds us that you are existing forever. Before the mountains came and the seas began to roar, you were there. And you make us like grass, flourishing in the morning, fading by the evening. Very temporary. Yet in the blink of an eye, as we can be turned back to dust, but for you, 1,000 years is like a passing of a few hours in the night. Lord, we pray that as we see you for who you are and recognize who we are, that we would be humbled as we consider your love. Lord, we are grateful that you restore us and that you heal us, for we are your people and you are our God. Amen.
Our first hymn this morning is a simple chorus. It just has two verses to it. It is entitled, I Sing Praises. So if you would, from where you are, please sing with me.
I sing praises to your name, O Lord, praises to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised.
Thank you so much, Dave. So we come to this time that we set aside to spend a few moments with our children, I would call your attention, girls and boys, and for these next few moments. One of the things that we all learn most basically when we are growing up, as soon as we can get to be able to understand much of anything, is we learn our numbers. 1 through 10 at least is what we start out with, and then of course we get bigger than that. But as we know those first numbers, 1 through 10, it's important for us to also know some how important three of those numbers are. And those numbers are 911. And 911 is certainly a powerful number. If you find yourself or your family in some sort of a emergency situation, if you will get a phone and dial those numbers, 911, as soon as you do that, someone on the other end will answer, how may I help you? What is your problem? What is taking place? And then you can tell them what's happened. Maybe your mom or dad has fallen, or maybe the house next door is on fire, or any number of things that could possibly happen that would be causing a problem for you or those that you know. You can simply dial 911 and you'll be able to get some help. Help will be sent on the way as quickly as humanly possible. And that's wonderful, isn't it? And that's not really just true in our country, but in many other countries around the world. It's sort of that universal three-digit number, 911, puts us in contact with those who will help. But what if we dialed 911 and nobody answered? It just rang and rang and rang. Suppose we lived in a world in which people really didn't care about anybody else except themselves. That would be a very terrible place to live. I'm glad that there are people who care, because Jesus cares, and he wants us as his followers to always care as well. In fact, in our scripture that we look at today, he said the two most important things in life, the two most important rules, if you will, are to love God and to love other people. And you know, when we love God and we love other people, then we don't have to worry about the minutiae of all the other rules that might be there, because Jesus says, if you get those two right, you've got everything right from that point. Let's take a moment and thank the Lord that he shows us the simple way of how to follow him. Lord, we thank you so much for this day, and thank you for these children, for their caregivers, for their parents, those who love them and care for them. And Lord, we pray that you would help them, as well as all of us, to be those who are able to not only love you, but to show our love for you by how we love those around us. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
We come now to a time of sharing our prayer needs, and I've had quite a few come my way, and I just wanted to share those with you. Miss Dorothy Winnies had a fall in her home, and she was in the hospital, but she is now at Liberty Commons, and I initially thought it was a broken leg, but it is a hairline fracture right above her kneecap. So she's going to be staying in Liberty Commons for a few weeks. So please be in prayer for her and her family. Barbara Larimore, we want to remember her. She's asked to be put on our prayer list. Kent Fowler's mom, Sarah Nobles, has been asked that we remember her. Miss Margaret from the Yachty House, she has had to leave there. She has had some dementia, so she is now in a facility that can deal specifically with that. But she was seen as a grandmother figure there at the Yachty House, and they will all miss her very much. So we want to be in prayer for the residents. You probably heard that James and Aubrey Harden have a new addition to their family. They have a brand new baby daughter, Tony Rose, And she is a little sister to Lily and Sophia and Ben, and I'm sure they are all fighting for their opportunity to hold her. Harold Bartley is undergoing tests over at Duke on his heart. This is a friend of Johnny and Kay Honeycutt's. Cole Miller may be starting dialysis before too long. Ms. Krista gave me this name and would like us to remember. Michael Shaw, we want to continue to remember him as he undergoes radiation treatments. And Bishop Darrell Banks, a friend of the Vesses, is home now, no longer on a ventilator, and is breathing well on his own and getting stronger every day. So that is an answered prayer. We also want to remember, Janice McCray told me that we need to be remembering the family of Ginger Scott. She had been battling cancer for 7 years, and she has a daughter and two boys who are sophomores at Whiteville High School. Dr. Sharon requests prayer for her right eye. She has upcoming surgery based on that prelude of "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing." It didn't sound like you had any problem with your vision, Dr. Sharon. It sounded like a wonderful prelude. But yes, we will continue to be praying for you. And here's a praise report. Eloise Watkins called me just the other day, and she called to say that her husband, Sammy, got test results back from the Gibson Cancer Center in Lumberton, and they detect no cancer on his lungs whatsoever. And that they, as a matter of fact, they went on to say that the next visit is scheduled for 3 months down the way. And Miss Eloise told me to tell everybody that she is very grateful for the prayers that have been lifted up on behalf of her husband Sammy and the family. So that's great. We've got some things to bring to the Lord, saying thank you, and things that we are concerned about. And let us go to our Father right now. Oh Lord, we thank you so much for your love and your mercy and your grace and your blessings that are so abundant. Lord, we thank you for the answered prayers. We thank you for this good news that we have had a pleasure to share. We thank you that your presence is felt in the lives of those who have lost someone dear to them. We beseech you, O Father, to stretch forth your healing hand and touch those who need to be touched by the great physician. Lord, we thank you that we are precious in your sight. We thank you that you are our constant. We thank you that you indeed lead us. We ask that we find ourselves always desirous of being led and guided by you. Lord, we love you. Thank you for loving us. These things we ask in your name. Amen. This morning, as I get ready to share a song, it's a song that we have sung many times before. It's the hymn, "He Leadeth Me." And prior to singing it, I wanted to share you a bit of backstory about it. The Civil War was being waged, and the outcome was still uncertain at the time. Joseph Gilmore was a pastor of Philadelphia's First Baptist Church, and he wanted to turn his people's attention away from the horrors of the war to the security of God's guidance in all things. So he turned to Psalm 23. The important thing, he said, is to know that God is leading no matter how or where he leads us. And after the service, Gilmore went to a deacon's home, and the conversation continued about the blessedness of God's leading. And as others went on talking, he wrote down the words of the hymn and gave it to his wife and forgot about it. 3 years later, up for a pastor's position in Rochester, New York, he thumbed through the hymnal and he spotted his hymn, "He Leadeth Me." His wife sent the words to a Christian periodical and they put it to music. And he said, "That was the first time that I knew that my hymn had found a place among the songs of the church." And for us, I say, for those who are led by the Lord, there are often delightful surprises.
Thank you so much, Dave and Ruth Ellen, for that wonderful anthem this morning. Come to that time in our service where we receive the offerings. As we have been through this pandemic, many have been so faithful sending their gifts, and we certainly appreciate that and honor that and trust that you are able to give as the Lord has blessed you as well. Let's bow now for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, as we come to this time of the offering, we acknowledge that biblical understanding that we don't own anything that you own everything, and everything that we have comes from your gracious hand. And Lord, we know that whatever we are able to return, it is simply that. We are returning a portion of what you have entrusted to our care, to the faithfulness of growing in our discipleship and the building of your kingdom. And it's in the name of Christ that we offer thanks for this opportunity. Amen. Our scripture text today is from Matthew 22, verses 34 through 40. Matthew 22, 34 through 40, continuing along with Jesus as he is there in the temple during the last week of his life. Hearing that, Jesus had silenced the Sadducees and the Pharisees. The Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question: "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" And Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." May the Lord bless these words to our hearts and to our lives this day. One of my favorite comedians is Jay Leno. He had quite a long run on The Tonight Show, and I always enjoyed watching him. I liked his humor. It was always funny humor. It wasn't belittling humor, but he always seemed to have the right thing to say. He is a fascinating character. One of the stories out of his past kind of gives you a hint of what he experienced as he was growing up. Leno said that as he was growing up in his house, there was one firm rule, and that was no one was ever allowed to take the Lord's name in vain. In fact, his mother used to tell him, "People might steal money because they have to eat, or they maybe get into a fight to protect somebody and have to go to prison, but there is no reason whatsoever to ever take the Lord's name in vain." And Jay grew up and, of course, became a famous comedian. And he and his father were at his home one night watching a fight between Roberto Duran and Sugar Ray Leonard on television. And one of the fighters was hit hard and fell. And in excitement, Jay took the Lord's name in vain. Well, his mother, who wasn't watching the fight, heard him. She walked from the kitchen, had a pot in her hand, and bonk, hit him right on the side of the head. "Jay, you'll not say that inside this house." Even though he was a grown man. But he understood that his mom was serious. It didn't quit when he left the house, that it was important that he be respectful to the Lord. I don't know about you, but I find that refreshing, because so much of our culture seems to be coming ruder and cruder in its language, and using God's name loosely without reverence is a part of a trend that you find sadly everywhere. And maybe we ought to give that some thought. It could maybe related to other areas where our society seems to be deteriorating or going in a wrong direction. When God's name simply becomes a way of expressing our anger or frustration or surprise or disgust, talks about that shows a little bit of where our character actually is. And one day, there in the temple, the Pharisee, who was an expert in the law, after the folks had tried to trick Jesus in various places with various questions, like last week, whether to pay tax or not, he comes with his question: "What is the greatest commandment in the law?" And of course, Jesus gives once again that famous reply that we are to love God with everything that we have, that great Shema. And then secondly, to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And if we can do that, love God and love others, then we have a good handle on what the most important commandments are. And this really is the very heart of the Judeo-Christian faith, to love God and to love our neighbor. Jesus taught that all the teachings, the Bible, both the law and the prophets, hang on these two hooks. And we often talk in church and in society about loving our neighbors, but so much of that is wrong in society is due to the fact that we really don't care that much about our neighbors. We care more about ourselves than we care about those around us. And even the first commandment is ignored. We don't really give that commandment very much attention anymore at all. And what does it mean to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind? Well, I think it means at least at a minimum that we are to treat the things of God with respect. Not only God's name, but everything associated with God ought to be treated with reverence. Seminary professor, retired now, Dr. Fred Craddock, was invited to a rural church to preach at an evening service. And there had been a terrible storm that afternoon, and the roads where he was were not paved. But he was determined to get there because he'd committed to leading the worship. So through the rain and over the slippy road and through the mud holes, he slid around until he finally arrived at the little country church there out in the wilderness. But it turns out that while he was slipping and sliding his way out to the little church, the leaders of the church had decided that it was so bad weather-wise that they just canceled the service. And of course, that was the days before cell phones, and everyone got a call except Dr. Craddock because he was in the car driving to get there. And when he got there, it was really too late for them to catch him. So two men decided to go on down to the church and tell him when he arrived that they had canceled the service that night. And having no idea the service was canceled, Dr. Craddock pulled up in the parking lot, and he walked in the open door. And he said two men greeted him, and they were sitting right there in the sanctuary, passing the time playing a game of cards. They weren't gambling, they were just simply playing cards, but they were playing cards on a table that said, "In remembrance of me," the communion table. Dr. Craddock said, "You know, a table is a table, made out of wood." He didn't say anything to the men about it, but he said his heart sort of sank, because a table isn't just a table, is it, when it's the Lord's table? We need to maybe not take things for granted nowadays, but there are some things that need to be considered as being different, which is what really the word holy is about, being different because it is associated with God. The ancient Jews believed that God was not only holy, but that he was holy, holy, holy. Even the name of God was so sacred that devout Jews would not write God's full name or ever speak it verbally. The Hebrew letters for God were YHWH, which we have translated as Yahweh. Earlier years, maybe used as Jehovah. But the Jews would not even speak that name. They would substitute the names Adonai, which is Lord, or Elohim for God, but never ever use or utter the holy name of God. And author Karen Burton Mays tells of traveling with a group to study there in the Holy Land. And in Jerusalem, they were interviewing a young Jewish scholar who had immigrated to Israel and become a naturalized Israeli citizen. And one of the women asked him a question, and in the question she referred to God as Yahweh. Kindly but sternly, as if restraining himself, the young scholar said, "First, before I answer your question, I must explain clearly that we would never utter the name as you have done, never speak it aloud, because it is too holy, too sacred to ever be spoken by a human being." And then he went on and answered her question. And Miss May says his words were a good reminder for me, as well as everyone else there, how far we have come in our journey away from holiness, when we hold nothing sacred, not even the spoken name of God. And of course, we can carry this too far. We can get into legalism like the Sadducees and the Pharisees and all those folks there in the first century. And such people who get so wrapped up in this struggle over whether to delete the word when writing God or writing on spiritual matters, should I just put a little line or a few dots or whatever? You know, that's might be getting to a point of carrying it to a point where your communication is not clear and it is not clearly understood what you are talking about if you're leaving words out, unless everyone sort of understands the rules of the game and the rules of the communication. But certainly we need to treat God's name and the things of God with respect. And by saying we love God, doesn't that also mean that we would want to spend time with God, not just treat the things of God with holiness? But what do you do when you love somebody? You want to stay away from them as far as possible and never have any contact whatsoever? No, you want to spend every moment possible with that person that you love. I remember when you first were falling in love, you couldn't spend enough time with your beloved. And so it is with God. That's why the saints through the ages have devoted so much of their life to prayer. That's the way in which we sort of are able to spend, to draw close to God. The author Robert Sawyer really writes a lot of novels, basically science fiction, if you know his name and his novels. But he always seems to have some spiritual insights and spiritual themes to his science fiction writing. And in one of Sawyer's books, people from Earth are having their first encounters with alien life from other planets. And one of the scientists from the planet Earth is surprised to learn that the aliens not only believe in God, they spend 8 hours a day in prayer. And the scientist from the Earth says, "What in the world can they be asking for that takes them 8 hours of prayer?" And to this question, the alien is shocked as well. And he said, "What does prayer have to do with asking for things?" A profound insight. What does prayer have to do with asking for things? And yet I suspect that when we mention prayer, that's what most of us think, making our request to God. Could it be that our self-centered little world has been warped to the point where we think that this is the only reason that we would ever go before the God who loves us, rather than simply spend time in God's presence, asking that the Lord would lead us and guide us and show us what we are to do in the moments of the day that is before us, how God would have us to act in certain circumstances and around the certain difficulties that we may be experiencing in our life, much like you would spend time talking with a trusted friend, sharing the needs and the desires and the concerns of your heart and in your life. And that is what spending time alone with God in prayer is about. And it's also should be something that we find ourselves in worship. Worship is really at the very heart of who we are as well, finding ourselves in God's presence and rejoicing in God's presence. Soren Kierkegaard was a Danish Christian philosopher who developed a theory about worship, and he used the term the theater of worship. And he was trying to make the point that too many people, even in his day, attended worship service as if they were attending a play. They see the ministers, the musicians, the choirs as actors, and they themselves as the audience. And in looking at themselves as being the audience, they felt that then they are free to critique the service as to whether it touched them or moved them or it didn't. They almost have the walk out feeling that they have the right to say, "Well, I didn't like the hymns. The choir didn't sound as good as they do sometimes. The sermon didn't make as much sense, didn't really speak to me. I didn't get anything out of worship." But Kierkegaard admonished his people to change their view of worship from a human view to a more biblical view, because Kierkegaard pointed out that worship is more of a time when the people in the congregation are also actors on the stage, as well as the ministers, the musicians, and the choir, because in worship, God is the audience. God is the object of our worship. What if after worship, God was evaluating our participation? just like you might be tempted to evaluate the worship service that you attend. And you hear God sort of saying, well, you know, Brother Jones was kind of slouching in his seat today, wasn't really paying very much attention when the prayers were being made or when the sermon was being preached. And Aunt Sally, well, I saw her. She was just looking around to see how all the other women, how they were all dressed and what their hair looked like. You know, that's absurd, of course, but the point is the purpose in worship, both as minister and people, is to enjoy being in the presence of God, our beloved. And if I happen to be boring that day, or if the choir is a little off, or if someone didn't set the thermostat right in the sanctuary, well, who cares? That's just sort of peripheral. We're here in God's presence, all of us. And that, of course, is important, and it helps us to understand this aspect of our relationship with God. And I think the most important way that we show our love for God is how we choose to live our life. When we leave this place of worship, our friends and our family will know whether we've been in the presence of God by how we live. It shows, and we don't really have to say much about it. The title for my sermon today comes from an illustration, actually a real-life experience that Pastor Jimmy Brown tells about when he was in the second grade. He said he remembers very vividly the very first girl who ever caught his eye. They were in the second grade, and he said up until that point he just wanted to throw rocks at girls. But this girl was different. He didn't want to throw rocks at her. Her name was Sherry. He said she was as cute as anything he had ever seen with his eyes. She had short little pigtails. She wore the sweetest little dress with a great big teddy bear on it. She also had the prettiest smile, especially with her middle tooth missing. Said she could jump out of the swing farther than any of the boys, and so he thought she was really probably pretty great, maybe even the greatest person he even knew. And he remembers one day how this beautiful girl passed him a note during class, and he unfolded it where nobody could see, and he looked in there, and it said, "Do you love me?" question mark. And then there was a box to check yes, and there was a box to check no. Well, he said he couldn't wait. He got out his pencil, and he checked yes, folded it back up, and sent it down the row so that she would get it. He said at recess that day, a little bit later on, Sherry came up to him with a big smile on her face and said, "Okay, say it." He was totally had no idea what she was talking about. "Say what? Say that you love me." It kind of embarrassed him, but Jimmy said, I went on immediately, said, "I love you." And the next day, Sherry came up to him again and said, "Do you really love me?" And he said, "Yes." "Do you mean it?" she asked seriously. She said, "A lot of boys tell me they love me, but some of them don't mean it." And even at the tender age of 7, Brown says, he knew the right answer to the question was, "Of course I mean it." He said that satisfied her for the rest of that day. But on the following day, she came up to him again and said, "If you love me and you mean it, then why don't you show it?" Good grief, he was thinking. I let her have my G.I. Joe eraser, and I stopped pulling her pigtails. I even made Tommy and Billy stop calling her names. What more does she want me to do? "You're supposed to hold my hand," she said, with a stern look on her face, "and play with me at recess, and sit next to me during free time. You're supposed to show it." Almost 25 years have passed since that day, and Pastor Jimmy Brown, he says, "It always makes me laugh when I think back to that second grade class. And it always amazes me how God can use the ordinary events of life that even a 7-year-old boy could teach him about God. For in that instant, God asked the same question that the little girl asked. Do you love me?" Of course, we always say, "Yes, of course, God, I love you." And then he says, "Say it. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so," as Psalm 107 puts it. "I love you, Lord," and we say it with a smile, particularly on Sunday mornings and during our prayer times. "But do you mean it?" he asked, "because a lot of people say they love me, but some of them don't mean it. This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me." "Of course I mean it," we quickly answer. "Then show it," God concludes. "If you love me, keep my commandments." Christian concludes, Jimmy Brown, "Do you love God? Do you really love him? Do you say it? Do you mean it? Do you show it? We say it with our words. We mean it in our heart. We show it with our actions. And after all, that's exactly what he did when Jesus came, told us about God, died on the cross for our sins, and was raised to new life. And how do we show our love for God? At least three. We treat with respect the things of God, including his name. We spend time in his presence in prayer and worship. We live the way that God wants us to live. And one day a Pharisee, an expert in the law, tested Jesus, "What's the greatest commandment?" And Jesus said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on those two commandments." Let's stand for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we are grateful once again that as we find ourselves in your presence, as we are confronted by the simple truths of loving you and loving those around us, that we are reminded of the depth of your great grace and great love. For Lord, you know how we struggle. You know how even giving our best effort and our best try often ends up in failure. And yet, Lord, you are always there to show us grace. Lord, we pray that you would give us the ability to truly love you with everything that we have and to show that love for you to those around us by loving them in that same manner. And we thank you for the opportunity to be your people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our closing hymn is the hymn, "More Love to Thee," and we will sing all three verses of it together.
This is my earnest plea, Lord.
Let's bow for the benediction. Eternal God, again, we are grateful for the opportunity of having been in your presence in corporate worship. And now as we leave, we also continue to leave and live in your presence as well. Lead us and guide us that we might reflect your love to those that are around us as they might see you living in and through us. And offer this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.